You had certain, not difficulties, but maybe there were difficulties. When you put a Braxas together, there were songs you had to push through, and having pushed them through, this became a tremendous success and is still fed off today by musicians. Can you just tell us a bit about Oye Como Va and the songs that you, Black Magic and the Samba, as I understand it, you had to force them onto this record. The companies didn't want them, you wanted them.
It was more like the band. Some musicians in the band didn't believe that Oye Como Va or Samba T particularly belonged in the Abraxas album. Because they said, well, it don't sound like rock and roll. It don't sound like, this song is going on the album, or I'm out of here. You guys want to get somebody else. It was the first time that I actually had to assert, because I was a very shy, introverted guy, very angry, but never imposing on people. I don't consider, that's when I started to say, I'm going to put my foot down and forget democracy. This song's go there, or I'm gone, And it's particularly Sound Apathy, because some people just didn't believe that song actually, this sounds too, romantic or something. Oye Como Va, and I dedicate this to my friend Tito Puente. It's a song that I heard really late at night, and when I heard it, it gave me the same feeling that I heard when I heard Louie Louie or Guantanamera or La Bamba, certain songs that they're tried and true tested in a Friday night crowd after school, whether you're Hebrew or white, Irish or Palestinian or from Glasgow, Friday night after school, you need a song that can party.
Promising background in Mexico, and not all that much later, you're a star of Woodstock, and you're crashing into the American top 10 with your band. Now, very, very successful. What did that do for you and the band?
It was too much too soon. Most people, they're not equipped to all of a sudden being a dishwasher, and the next minute, you're a god, and they put too many things on you. Everywhere you go, people recognize you. You turn on the radio, just about every station plays your music.
But that's exciting, isn't it? That's what you want.
Yeah, it's exciting, but at the same time, there's a part of your soul that feels like it's being kind of crushed, because...
But it's better than the other way, that no radio station playing your music. You got very angry when that happened.
Well, the thing that is crushing is the pressure, because then you start feeling enormous pressure, to come up with a better album and top this and top that, For me, I was just lonely, I was just downright lonely, and I got tired of picking out people who smell funny, and I have immediately called cabs and sent them home, every other night or whatever, like most teenagers, or people in that position. I was looking for a person who could smell right, and that I would want to wake up with that person for the rest of my life. And my wife came in, Deborah, in 72. at the peak of Abraxas, at the peak of all that, I kept my promise when I was a child to my mom. When I grow up and I play music, I'm going to buy you a house and dishwasher and a washing machine and you know, all the things that kids promise when they're kids, you know. But I kept my promise, you know, so all my promises were fulfilled.
Do you think that the drugs helped the music?
Yes.
In what way?
Without the experience, there wouldn't be no Jimi Hendrix experience. He'd be playing corny songs. You know, I don't consider Purple Haze, Foxy Lady, All Along the Watchtower. Those songs would have never been done without the input of mescaline or LSD or acid. Pure cocaine, pure heroin wouldn't take you there. You know, because those are slave drugs. They enslave you. Mescaline, peyote, LSD, they free you. It's like a snake. You shed your skin. It's scary. You shouldn't take it if you're a bad person, if you have bad intentions, you know, if you're not a nice person. You shouldn't take those things. You're not going to have a good time because life will slap you in the face. If you're a nice person, you can take those things. You will be filled with glee and joy, and you will discover innocence to a whole other level. But yes, music was an echo of a self-exploration opposed to self-masturbation or whatever, you know. It was, you can tell when Eric Clapton went from just straight ahead blues to Cream. Jimi Hendrix at his best, and Eric Clapton at his best, which people call the biggest gods of guitar. It's not even about Jimi Hendrix or Eric Clapton. They became instruments that channel a whole other kind of music that even they cannot play sometimes at their best. And they'll be the first ones to tell you, Stevie Ray, Jimi Hendrix, and Eric Clapton, or Jeff Beck, the best music that Beethoven or Stravinsky or we all play is beyond your grasp, is when you channel and it goes through you. And this is a reality. This is reality, folks.
The reality also was that Hendrix and Joplin and Morrison, to name but three, died very young because of drugs. Did that jolt you when these deaths came?
Yes, they died because of drugs, not because of medicine, because they didn't know when to say... One of the best things about, I don't like Clint Eastwood movies, but one of the best things that he ever said is, a man should know his limitations. You know, a man should know his limitations. And they didn't have any way to say, well, you know, how high can you get? You know, are you having fun? If you're not having fun, maybe you should stop and be high and being straight for a while. Go smell the roses. Go jump in a swimming pool or jump in the ocean. There's a lot of ways to get high. But they didn't have people around them to balance, you know, and some of them actually started believing all the crap that people say in the press about them. You know, that's the worst thing that can happen to you when you start believing all that stuff about that you're a god and this and that, you know.